Welcome to the Roman Catholic Pride Podcast, where I stand against the pride celebrated by the world and teach the humility of Jesus Christ and His Church. If you find value in my content, please like and share these episodes. It is available on Gab TV, YouTube, and audio only as a podcast on Anchor FM, Spotify, and Google Podcasts. I do apologize. It has been about a month since I've last shared an episode. I've been dealing with some personal issues and family problems, and so I would ask your prayers for this private intention of mine, and I do apologize for kind of losing touch here, but hopefully I can get back into the swing of things here and do more with the website, which I just renewed my site hosting on. And so I hope to really grow the website and the podcast in the next 12 months at least. So I ask you to please pray for this apostolate, that I might serve God faithfully and faithfully teach His Word. And so we continue with the series of articles I have been covering from the SSPX on the question of papal heresy. And this is the last part, part six. And there's actually two parts to part six. There was a part 6A and a part 6B. And we'll cover both of those in this episode. There was a part 7, but I can't seem to locate the text of part 7. It seems to have been pulled completely from the internet. So if anybody has a copy of that or knows where I can get access to that, if you can email me at randy@romancatholicpride.com, that's randy@romancatholicpride.com, you can email me there. And if I can find that 7th article, we'll cover that also. So we'll cover this today, and then I was going to get into the issue of sedevacantism. I think I'm going to put that aside for right now, because I'd like to cover some spiritual writings from the saints, because I think, especially as we get closer to Advent, I would really like to get into more spiritual discussions and more spiritual practices, and right now my soul needs that to keep me on the right path. And so I hope you'll forgive me. We will get back to the issue of sedevacantism at a later point in time. So now on with the article of the question of papal heresy, part 6A, which looks at the question of, does a pope who falls into heresy lose his investiture in the primacy? Again, these series of articles were written by Father Jean-Michel Gleize, who had been a professor at the SSPX's seminary of St. Pius X in Econe, Switzerland, teaching ecclesiology. Now on to the article. The opinion before Vatican II. The theologians who lived until Vatican Council II all answered this question in the affirmative. They are unanimous in declaring this fact. In the person of a pope, the possession of the supreme pontificate is incompatible with heresy. They are no longer unanimous when it comes to explaining this fact and indicating the reason for it. Cardinal Juan de Torquemada, who lived from 1388 to 1468, in his Summa de Ecclesia, Book 4, Part 2, Chapters 18 to 20, writes that in the person of the pope, the papacy is incompatible not only with external, but even with internal heresy. The mere fact that the pope adheres in the internal forum of his conscience to an error contrary to doctrine would result in the cessation of his papal office. The common opinion of medieval theologians is that a heretical pope in the external and not just internal forum must and can be deposed by a human authority, since there is, they claimed, here on earth a power above his. This authority is superior to the pope by way of exception in the case of heresy. This could be the authority of the College of Cardinals or possibly of an ecumenical council. Cajetan's thesis. Cajetan, who lived from 1469 to 1534, in chapters 20 to 21 of his 1511 treatise, De Comparatione Auctoritatis Papae et Concili holds that there is an authority that can undo the investiture. In other words, cause the existence of the pontifical authority and the Pope's possession of it to cease. But Cajetan tries to differentiate his view from that of the theologians of the previous period by maintaining in principle that on earth there can be no authority superior to the Pope, not even in the case of heresy. Indeed, the authority that is required to cause the investiture to cease would be exercised not on the Pope, but on the connection that exists between the person of the Pope and the papacy. Cajetan's thesis is adopted by Benicio Banez, who lived from 1528 to 1604, and by St. John of St. Thomas, who lived from 1589 to 1644. More recently, Cardinal Charles Jaunet, who lived from 1891 to 1975, considered the argument penetrating. It is made up of two aspects. First, in De Comparatione, chapter 20, 280 and 281, Cajetan states an authentic principle. The solution to the problem raised must be rooted in the sources of revelation. Now, divine law is content to say that if the Pope becomes heretical, the Church must avoid him. In fact, we can cite at least six passages of Scripture in which God commands his people not to relate to a formal public heretic. Passages cited by Cajetan in 280 include Numbers 16, verse 26, quote, "Depart from these wicked men," unquote. Galatians 1, verse 8, "Let him be anathema," unquote. In other words, separate yourselves from him. 2 Thessalonians 3, verse 6, quote, "Withdraw yourselves from him," unquote. And 2 John, verse 10, quote, "Receive him not into the house, nor say to him, Godspeed to you," unquote. The most eloquent passage, which Cajetan moreover cites constantly rather than the five others, is the one from the Epistle of St. Paul to Titus, chapter 3, verse 10, quote, "Hominem hereticum post unam et secundum corruptionem de vita," unquote. Quote, "A man that is a heretic after the first and second admonition, avoid," unquote. Consequently, divine revelation teaches us no more and no less than this. The Church must avoid any dealings with the heretical Pope. Avoiding a heretical Pope. Cajetan then proceeds to justify his own theory. He says that there is only one means of avoiding having anything to do with the heretical Pope, in keeping with the requirement of divinely revealed law. This means in the exercise of a ministerial power that is not a power of jurisdiction, strictly speaking, the use of which implies no superiority over the Pope. Indeed, this power is none other than the very power that the Church uses to establish the Pope in his ministry. Its precise object is not the person of the man who receives the papacy, nor the papacy, in other words, the Pope as such, but the connection between the two, in other words, the relation that exists between the person who receives the papacy and the papacy itself. This power can be exercised in two directions, both to undo the connection as well as to make it. To illustrate this idea, Cajetan turns to an example. The generation or the corruption of a man is caused by an agent that has power over the union between a matter and a form, inasmuch as it disposes the matter, without thereby having power over the form. Similarly, the Church has the power to give the papacy to the person who receives it, or to take it away from the one who loses it, inasmuch as she disposes this person, without thereby having power over the papacy. As John of St. Thomas remarks, this explanation avoids saying that the Church is above the Pope as such. Indeed, the Church acts here only as an instrumental cause or to bring about either the investiture or the cessation thereof. In the first case, the Church causes in the person of the Pope the disposition required for the investiture, which is the appointment to the See of Rome. In the second case, the Church causes in the person of the Pope a disposition that is incompatible with the office of the Pope, which results therefore in the loss of the office. This incompatible disposition that the Church causes is, the argument says, the notoriety of the heresy. And the incompatibility between the notorious heresy and the supreme pontificate is said to be taught by divine revelation in Titus 3, verse 10. Suarez's opinion. Francisco Suarez, who lived from 1548 to 1617, in his De Fide Disputatio 10 De Summo Pontifice, section 6, 3-13, Opera Omnia 12, 316-318, states, like Cajetan, that the Pope does not lose his pontificate by reason of his heresy itself, whether it be occult or even notorious, but then presents what in his opinion is the common explanation of the theologians. A publicly and incorrigibly heretical, i.e. pertinacious, Pope loses the pontificate when the Church declares his crime. This declaration constitutes a legitimate act of jurisdiction, but it is not a jurisdiction that exercises a superior power over the Pope. In this case, the Church is represented not by the cardinals, but by the ecumenical council. The latter can be convoked by someone other than the Pope, since it does not meet to define faith and morals. Suarez then explains the essential points of his thesis. He refuses to say that in this exceptional case the Church possesses a true power of jurisdiction over the Pope. The Church does nothing but declare, in the name of Christ, the Pope's heresy, which amounts to declaring that the Pope has become unworthy of the papacy, and by means of this declaration of the Church, Christ immediately takes the papacy back from the Pope. In a third logical moment, the Pope has fallen from his office, becomes inferior to the Church, and she can punish him. The thesis, therefore, is based entirely on one truth. This truth is that the previous declaration of the Church that notes the Pope's heresy is the necessary and sufficient condition for Christ to withdraw the papacy from the Pope. And Suarez proves this truth by saying that it is spelled out in the divine law of Revelation. In support of this, Suarez also cites Titus 3, verse 10, along with a passage from the first epistle of St. Clement of Rome, which allegedly says that Petrum docuisse hereticum papam esse deponendum. Sorry for my slaughtered Latin there. Quote, that Peter, who has taught something heretical, must be deposed as a pope, unquote. St. Bellarmine's opinion. The opinion of St. Robert Bellarmine, who lived from 1542 to 1621, which is found in De Romano Pontifice, Book 2, Chapter 30, and which is followed by Cardinal Billot, who lived from 1846 to 1931, is purely theoretical because his real thesis is that the Pope will never fall into heresy. Assuming, nevertheless, that per impossible the Pope happened to fall into public heresy, he would ipso facto lose the pontificate. As Bellarmine explains clearly, the basis for this thesis is that a notorious heretic as such is no longer a member of the Church. Now, the Pope necessarily must be part of the society of which he is the head. This is why the heretical Pope, no longer being a member of the Church, ceases to be her visible head. If we adopt this explanation of St. Robert Bellarmine and of Cardinal Billot, the disputed question then is, as of what moment can one say that the heresy is notorious in the case of the Pope? The Church's historic canon law, CIC 1917, Canons 2264 and 2314 allows for persons other than the Pope an intermediary situation in which, if the heresy has not been manifested sufficiently, all acts of jurisdiction in the external forum would remain valid, albeit illicit, By analogy, a pope who is formally but not yet notoriously heretical could for some time remain at the head of the church. But Billot adds that Providence could not permit the whole church to acknowledge as her head a formal heretic. If the elected man is or becomes formally heretical, this acknowledgement could not persist, and this is why the notoriety would have to appear rather quickly in one way or another. At the very most, it could happen that only a few Petri experts in the church were endowed with the necessary theological intelligence to assess the whole situation. The others, in other words, almost the totality of the church, would not be capable of understanding the whole import of the crisis, even though their virtue of faith sufficed for their personal conduct. St. Thomas Aquinas makes a similar distinction when he speaks about majores and minores, the greater and the lesser, with regard to the notoriety of the Messiah among the Jews. A delegation from God. Finally, a recent study by Father Guillaume de Villiers in part 6 of his study on the doctrine Sociale et Politique et l'École de Saint Thomas, at Article 9 in the journal Le Sel de la Terre, 54, pages 165 to 168, arrives at different conclusions. One can even go so far as to say these conclusions are truly new and therefore deserve wide attention, even though one may claim that they are based on the above-cited theologians, in particular on Cajetan. The hypothesis says, the Church, like any other society, has the power to depose a heretical pope by a delegation received from God in the case of heresy. The proof rests on two arguments. One, the authority of St. Clement of Rome in a passage from his epistle to the Corinthians, and two, an analogy with what happens in civil society in the case of tyranny. This boils down to saying, and the author states this explicitly at the outset of his study, that everything is based not on the divine positive law of revelation, but on simple natural law. Indeed, our author notes that all theologians have endeavored to justify their theses by citing the facts of revelation in Christ's positive institution. According to them, the deposal of the heretical pope would be necessary according to the teaching of Scripture and tradition. Now, it is clear that revelation does not teach that. This is why the remaining option is to turn to the natural law. It is enough to apply the principle that the supernatural order presupposes the natural order. The church is a society. Now, in every society, natural divine law requires that in a case of tyranny, the citizens proclaim the dethronement of a power that may still be legal but has become illegitimate. And on the other hand, this natural divine law, which applies to the case of the city, equals society, of the natural order remains valid also in the case of the church, because she is a city in the supernatural order. This is why it is not only licit but necessary to depose a heretical pope, but because the pope is to the church what a tyrant is to natural society. And in order to do this, society receives, in that case, delegation from God. Editor's note, the sixth part of Father Gleize's precise study of whether or not a heretical pope loses his investiture will continue with an examination of how Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre and the Society of St. Pius X has responded to the problem of popes who appear to favor heresy, and the fact that the near totality of the hierarchy and the faithful are today overcome by the false ideas of liberalism and modernism. The third and concluding portion of part 6 will then follow. And again, a side note, that is the end of part 6a. I have not been able to find that third part to part 6. So if anybody knows how to get that, please either comment below or send me an email at randy@romancatholicpride.com. And so now we turn to part 6b, which will be the final part in this series. And this part begins with this statement. In this second part of the conclusion in this series, Father Gleize discusses two distinct approaches to this question and Archbishop Lefebvre's prudence. So again, this is the second part, part 6b. And another note, that's here says readers should take particular note here of how the Society of St. Pius X has approached this problem, not as a speculative matter, but as a matter of prudential judgment. So part 6b, does a pope who falls into heresy lose his investiture in the primacy? Two approaches to the question of heresy. Following on what has been said in part 6a, we can therefore pose the question about the heresy of the pope in two different ways. First, as a purely speculative problem, abstracting from all circumstances. Then, we stick to purely theological reasons, which are supposed to be valid in all cases, but are only probable and remain insufficient to provide speculative certitude, since only a still non-existent argument of magisterial authority could give an apodictic answer. Secondly, as a prudential problem, while taking into account the circumstances, the solution of which could be applied only to a single case. We stick then not to what is certain, theologically speaking, but to what is surest given the circumstances. The judgment of Archbishop Marcel Lefebvre of the Society of St. Pius X on the crisis of the Church is not a theoretical, purely speculative judgment, as is a mathematical judgment. It is a practical and prudential judgment. This explains why it could evolve and be modified by reason of new circumstances. Conversely, the judgment of the Set of Acontist and the Ecclesia Deists is a mathematical judgment that tries to stick to a unique universal conclusion that is true and certain in all circumstances. Speculative opinions remain debatable. As for the purely speculative opinions of the older theologians, they remain debatable on that same level of speculation. The opinion of Juan de Torquemada, see part 6a, is improbable. Moreover, it is presented as an objection and refuted by Cajetan in his De Comparatione in chapters 17, 19, and 22. Heresy committed in the internal forum of the conscience is unverifiable. If it entails the loss of the supreme pontificate, it will never be possible to verify this, and the Church will never have certitude about a possible cessation of the investiture. Such a situation contradicts the essentially visible character of the Church. The opinion of the medieval theologians, which acknowledges that the Church has a power to depose the Pope if necessary, contradicts the divine constitution of the Church. Cajetan recognizes that this thesis mentioned in an objection was, at least in his era, the common opinion. But it does not hold up because since the Pope is above the Church by divine right, if there is an exceptional case in which the Church has power over him, this case must be explicitly foreseen and stated as such in the sources of Revelation. Now, quote, when we consider the exceptional case of heresy, divine law does not foresee that the Pope should be subject to the Church, unquote. See De Comparatione, chapter 20. This is why the explanation set forth by these theologians should be rejected. It contradicts the explicit teaching of Revelation. Cajetan's explanation suffers from a weakness that is without a doubt fatal to it, for it begs the question, supposing that the authentic meaning of Titus 3:10 and of other similar passages in Scripture is the sense required in order to be able to prove the alleged interpretation. Now this supposition is purely gratuitous. St. Paul says that it is necessary to avoid a notorious heretic, no more and no less. On the basis of that, nothing proves that a notoriously heretical pope is dismissed from his office, because nothing says that the situation of someone who must be avoided by the faithful is incompatible with the title of the papacy. Despite the paradoxical attractiveness of this assertion, at first glance, it is still possible to avoid having anything to do with a notoriously heretical pope without therefore considering him as being dethroned from the papacy. Lefebvre's prudential approach. Archbishop Lefebvre's supernatural prudence in the present situation of the Church since Vatican Council II demonstrates this sufficiently. A good summary of this attitude is given by the declaration of fidelity to the positions of the Society of Pope Pius X. Quote, I, the undersigned, recognize Francis as Pope of the Holy Catholic Church, That is why I am ready to pray in public for him as Supreme Pontiff. I refuse to follow him when he departs from Catholic tradition, especially in the questions of religious liberty and ecumenism, as also in the reforms which are harmful to the Church." Unquote. This expression, quote, "I refuse to follow him," unquote, neatly corresponds to the De Vita of St. Paul, and it does not rule out the, quote, "I recognize," unquote. Billot contra Cajetan speculative opinion. Returning to the matter of speculative opinions, we can also add, to confirm the first argument, which is the main argument of the refutation, that Cajetan's explanation, in reality, does not avoid saying that the Church is above the Pope. Cardinal Billot saw this clearly in his Traité de l'Église du Christ, Question 14, Thesis 29, Part 2, pages 605 to 606, Numbers 940 to 941, quote, "Let no one say that the deposal could still be understood not as the direct withdrawal of the papacy, since this power is given directly by God and subordinates all other power in the Church to itself, but rather as a simple change of subject, inasmuch as one would withdraw from the Pope the legitimacy that acquired his election for him. In fact, far from being the contrary corresponding to the election, this change of person is dependent on another order, for it corresponds to an act of jurisdiction and to the exercise of a power. This is why the objection's conclusion does not follow. Just because the person of the Pope can be designated by men, this does not mean that the latter have the legitimate power to dismiss the person of the Pope from the papacy. The Church, or an ecclesiastical assembly, cannot perform any act upon the person of the Pope, except for the election. And therefore, once the election is canonically terminated, the Church has nothing more to do until a new election takes place, which can occur only after the see becomes vacant." Unquote. And further, Billot observes the following, quote, "Cajetan takes a lot of trouble without managing to show how it would be possible to keep these three principles together. A pope who has fallen into heresy is not thereby deposed by virtue of divine law, nor by virtue of human law. The pope who remains pope has no superior on earth. If the pope loses the faith, the Church has the power to depose him all the same. But one may reply that, if the pope who has fallen into heresy remains pope and can be deposed by the Church, one or the other of these two consequences must necessarily be admitted. Either the fact of deposing the Pope does not require the one who deposes him to have power over him, or else the Pope, while remaining Pope, is really subject on earth to his superior power, at least in a particular situation. Moreover, as soon as we open the door to a deposal, there is no longer any reason to restrict it by the very nature of things or by virtue of a positive law to deposal solely in the case of heresy. For then we have already destroyed the principles that make the deposal impossible in general, and nothing remains but a voluntaristic rule accompanied by an arbitrarily defined exceptional case." Shortcomings in Suarez and Bellarmine's explanations. Suarez's explanation, see Part 6a, is original. In fact, it can be likened neither to Cajetan's nor to St. Robert Bellarmine's. For Cajetan, the Church alone causes the Pope's dethronement. For St. Robert Bellarmine, it is Christ alone. For Suarez, it is Christ and the Church at the same time. We should note in passing that this way of viewing the problem is characteristic of his eclecticism. Suarez has a lot of erudition, but little genius. He does not synthesize. He always has trouble deciding among opposing authorities, and his tendency is to reconcile them in a sort of middle-of-the-road solution. In acting this way, he weakens the principles. This, incidentally, is the main reason why Father Reginald Garrigou-Lagrange disapproves of Suarez. For example, in De Christo Salvatore, pages 108 to 109, Father Garrigou-Lagrange writes, quote, "In this question, Suarez, as is often the case with his eclecticism, refutes Scotus by relying on St. Thomas, and St. Thomas by relying on Scotus. But this intermediate position is very difficult to hold. and it is not at all easy to preserve its equilibrium or stability. And this is why it is not uncommon for Suarez, when he sets forth his theses, to waver or oscillate between St. Thomas and SCOTUS without finding a firm position. For more on this topic, see the book by Michael Villet, La Formation de la Pensée Juridique Moderne, Presses Universitaires de France, 2003, pages 351 to 353. It is important to remember that Suarez is a man of his times, and the deep trends that he expresses already herald modern positivism. For Cajetan, the Church deposes the Pope without thereby exercising a power that was superior to the papacy. Christ does not intervene. It is enough for the Church to annul the final condition, which is sufficient, but nonetheless required by investiture, so that it can produce its fruit. Everything happens at the level of the previous disposition. For St. Robert Bellarmine, Christ denies the formal heretic's investiture inasmuch as he is a formal heretic. The Church has no role to play. For Suarez, the Church prepares, so to speak, the way to Christ so that he can depose his vicar. The same critique can be made of this explanation as of Cajetan's. Suarez supposes that the passage by St. Paul to Titus justifies his thesis. Now, we have seen that that is not the case at all. As for the passage from the first epistle of St. Clement of Rome, which both Cajetan and Suarez rely upon, the text cannot be found in the editions of the authentic works of St. Clement. It is probably apocryphal. St. Robert Bellarmine's opinion was no doubt common until the time of Vatican II, but the situation that has emerged since then modifies the particulars of the problem. The opinion is therefore a probable approach to a solution in a certain context, but it could not be applied to every context. As we explained earlier, this way of solving the theoretical problem is not a universal principle of responding in practice to it. End of Part 6b. So I hope that you have enjoyed this six-part series of the question of a papal heresy from the Society of St. Pius X. And I'll just say at the end of this that I am a member of the Society of St. Pius X, or rather I attend an SSPX chapel, and I hold to the majority of the positions of the SSPX, though I will say on the question of a heretical pope, my opinion is that while one cannot make a definitive statement on whether the current pontiff or even former pontiffs, whether they were legitimate or not, there is good reason to believe that they are illegitimate. Due to the heresies that they have stated and the heresies that they have promoted. In particular, Pope Francis has said some very heretical things about the role of Christ in the Church, and also the state of divorced and remarried people in the Church, and in some of the practices he has allowed, or at least that he has not spoken against, i.e. Homosexual priest and clergy. All these things are very troubling, and I think lead to at least a reasonable belief that he is not a legitimate pontiff. And I think things that former popes have done, when one looks at John Paul II and some of the things that happened at Assisi, the ecumenism that he and Ratzinger promoted, these things all lead one to believe that these popes were heretical and that they did not legitimately hold the seat of Peter. And while one can reasonably hold that position, we can't speak definitively on that position because, one, I do not have the authority as an individual Catholic, and I know of no authority in the Church that can make a definitive proclamation on this. And that's why I do not go the full road of claiming to be a set of a contest. I would rather say that there is a legitimate reason to believe that these people are not true pontiffs, and therefore we do not need to hold to their authority. I know there's some who will take offense of this, and I welcome your comments, and I welcome any correction that you have to make. And so may God bless you and keep you, and we will speak again hopefully in a week. I will have a new podcast episode out, and we will look at some more spiritual writings of some saints. And hopefully we'll do that for a bit, and then we'll get back to the question of sedevacantism at a later time. So please remember to like and share this episode, and check out the previous episodes in this series on the question of papal heresy. I will leave a link at the bottom directing you to this article so that you can read these for yourself. And I also welcome you to check out my website, www.romancatholicpride.com. And you can also follow me on Twitter, where I go by at TradCatProud. So thank you, and God bless you.